Greetings. If you are Muslim, I encourage you to watch this whole video to gain understanding. I've recently read some Islamic sites that argue as follows. Jesus is the Son of Man. The Old Testament tells us not to trust the Son of Man. Therefore, the Bible really tells you to not believe Jesus. The only verse offered from the Old Testament is the following. Psalm 146:1, Praise ye the Lord, praise the Lord, O my soul. While I live will I praise the Lord. I will sing praises unto my God while I have any being. Put not your trust in princes, nor in the Son of Man, in whom there is no help. The entire misunderstanding is too key on the phrase Son of Man. But more than a simple misunderstanding, I gather this is yet another example of the fine quality of Islamic thinking. It really deserves to be called the untrustworthy Son of Man jihad. And like so many jihads of Islam against the truth, Islam depends on ignorance of God's word. Let's begin to dismantle it brick by oh-so-clear brick. The God of the prophets is not afraid of questions or knowledge. In fact, God encourages thinking that Satan's Islam retards. 2 Timothy 2:15, Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The Bible teaches believers to study. And it even explains why you should study the Word of God, so that you may rightly divide the Word of Truth. To rightly divide is to discern the true meaning of the Word of Truth. Remember the one verse offered as evidentiary support for this jihad. Put not your trust in princes, nor in the Son of Man, in whom there is no help. If the extent of your effort is merely to contrive and invent a jihad against the message of the prophets, this is where you should stop. One simple statement ripped out of context of the whole message. But do you think the phrase Son of Man only appears once? Actually, the phrase Son of Man is used many times in multiple ways. Let's respect God enough to be honest in examining His Word. The Word of God refers to humans in general as sons of man. Ecclesiastes 2:8, I also gathered for myself silver and gold and the treasure of kings and provinces. I got singers, both men and women, and many concubines, the delight of the sons of man. Ecclesiastes 9:12, Moreover, man does not know his time. Like fish caught in a treacherous net and birds trapped in a snare, so the sons of men are ensnared at an evil time when it suddenly falls on them. Note, this is Prophet Solomon recording his wisdom, which is the way God inspired the prophets to write. Also, God might refer to an individual human he was addressing as Son of Man. Ezekiel 33:2, Son of man, speak to the children of thy people, and say to them, When I bring the sword upon a land, if the people of the land take a man of their coasts and set him for their watchman. Here the phrase Son of Man is used by God to indicate his prophet Ezekiel. This is about like saying, You, frail human of the dust of the earth. It would not be logical to think God was confusing prophet Ezekiel with Jesus. God uses the phrase Son of Man to imply descent from man or begotten of a human. Numbers 23:19. God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Has he said and shall he not do it? Or has he spoken and shall he not make it good? Here, as Moses is describing God, Moses says God is not the Son of Man. That usage means God does not have a human father. But if your mind is shaped by the Islamic Jihad, you may twist that passage as well. God is not the Son of Man, so if Jesus is the Son of Man, God cannot be Jesus. But again, that is not rightly discerning what is being stated by Moses, the prophet of God. Job 25:6, how much less man, who is a maggot, and the son of man, who is a worm? Here the text refers to the lowly position of man. Or, by the logic of the untrustworthy son of man jihad, does this call Jesus a worm? Not in any way. Context, context, context. Who said this and what were they talking about? And if we look at the context of Job 25:6, we should begin with Job 25:1. Then Bildad the Shuhite answered and said, the words of Job 25:6 are actually the record of what some man stated, not God. You see, the Islamic mythology is that the Quran is character for character the spoken text from Allah. That is part of the one-upsmanship of Muhammad to try and exceed the religion of the Jews and Christians. The Torah and Bible are the inspired word of God, but the Quran is better being the words of Allah, his own self. Getting back on track, Job 25 records the words of a man and not God's spoken speech. God has caused or inspired the prophets to record what various men said and did. This is often to teach us about human thinking and human nature. It does not mean the words are a command from God or an example how to behave. We must respect God, the text, and the context in order to rightly discern what is meant and by whom. Job 35:8, thy wickedness may hurt a man as thou art, and thy righteousness may profit the son of man. Another example, whose wickedness is spoken of here? Based on the context, this is Elihu rebuking Job. Then Elihu continued and said, so this is Elihu, a man giving Job counsel. Thy wickedness may hurt a man as thou art, and thy righteousness may profit the son of man. It is not reasonable to think this refers to Job's righteousness benefiting Jesus. Again, we see we cannot simply rape the context the way Islam trains its followers to do. This is always the way Islam disregards the message of the prophets, even while Islam dishonestly claims to respect the Torah and Bible. Surah 2:136, say, O believers, we have believed in Allah and what has been revealed to us, and what has been revealed to Abraham and Ishmael and Isaac and Jacob and the descendants, and what was given to Moses and Jesus, and what was given to the prophets from their Lord. We make no distinction between any of them, and we are Muslims to him. Talk about a hypocritical lie from hell. The claim of no distinction is an absolute lie. Again, getting back on track, if the phrase Son of Man is negative, why does Jesus apply it to himself? The answer, found through honest study of God's message by the prophets, is not every mention of Son of Man is negative. We have seen the term Son of Man used as a general reference to a human being or a prophet. But there is another particular example by Prophet David that implies likeness to a human, but very special. Daniel 7:13, I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Here we see this phrase, like the Son of Man. It implies a similarity, such that casual observation would perhaps not be able to tell the difference. Someone just looking at Jesus might not be able to tell anything special about him. And to him meaning, and to this Son of Man. The Son of Man is now referring to a specific individual. And to him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom, that all the peoples, nations, and men of every language might serve him. The term serve includes implication of worship, and only Yahweh God is worthy of worship. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which will not pass away, and his kingdom is one which will not be destroyed. The individual here, referred to as the Son of Man, is eternal. His kingdom is eternal. An eternal being with an eternal kingdom. Who do you think that might be? It implies someone with God-like attributes, who Prophet Daniel revealed to be like the Son of Man. So from this unique passage, we see a description of a unique individual to come, the Son of Man. The passage is unique because it speaks of an eternal being, and yet one similar enough to mankind to be like a human being. But the description around this one who is like a Son of Man highlights differences worth remembering. And that is not the only mention of this individual who is one like the Son of Man. Revelation 1:13, and among the lampstands was one like the Son of Man, dressed in a long robe with a golden sash around his chest. And elsewhere in Revelation, Revelation 14:14, and I looked and saw a white cloud, and seated on the cloud was one like the Son of Man, with a golden crown on his head and a sharp sickle in his hand. Notice this one like the Son of Man is seated on the cloud. Then another angel came out of the temple, calling in a loud voice to the one seated on the cloud, "Swing your sickle and reap, because the time has come to harvest, for the crop of the earth is ripe." So the one seated on the cloud swung his sickle over the earth, and the earth was harvested. So the one like the Son of Man harvests the earth with a swing of his sickle, with one wave of his sickle-filled hand. Call me crazy, that seems godlike to me. Jesus called himself the Son of Man because he was revealing he was this one like the Son of Man foretold by Prophet Daniel. Matthew 9:6, but so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, then he said to the paralytic, "Get up, pick up your mat, and go home." Jesus referred to himself as the Son of Man and said he had authority to forgive sins while on the earth. Again, the Son of Man is godlike, but in human form. Who but God can forgive sins? We respect this along with all the prophets who said God would come in the flesh. Matthew 8:20, Jesus replied, "Foxes have den and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." Mark 14:21, "For the Son of Man must die, as the Scriptures declared long ago. But how terrible it will be for the one who betrays him. It would be far better for that man if he had never been born." Matthew 16:27, "For the Son of Man is going to come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and will then repay every man according to his deeds." Matthew 24:30, "At that time the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn. They will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory." So we see in some contexts the phrase Son of Man is a general term for a human being. But we also see in some contexts this Son of Man is divine, eternal, and godlike. And to know which is which, one must respect God enough to respect God's message. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Son of Man, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.